And now, please, first panel, could you please take seats? Well, it's happening a couple of words about practical side. We hope for active participation of the audience, and therefore we encourage you to pose your questions also, not just if you are asked to, but using Twitter hashtag Quo Vadis. And for you, if you do this, of course, this will be visible on the screens. This could help also to make it more interactive and lively. Also, after this first panel, there will be coffee break for half an hour, and it will take place in the restaurant Cleversal, just opposite side of the hall. And after second panel, Bank of Latvia will host a lunch, and everybody is invited from the conference to join. Thank you. Please, floor is yours.
Well, welcome to our discussion today about debt and whether or not it hinders growth. My name is John O'Donnell. I'm a journalist with Reuters. I've written for the last 8 years about the economic crisis in Europe, in Frankfurt, the home of the European Central Bank, and also in Brussels, where a lot of the politicians have tried to figure out how to solve the problem. And 8 years in, a lot of the problems, I would say, still haven't been recognized. I live in Germany, and Germany is a country where the word Schuld equates not only to debt, but also to guilt, even has a little connotation of sin. And this is the, I would say, the hardcore guardian of debt austerity in Europe, and that's resented by a lot of countries on the periphery. I know that the governor today said more debt is equivalent to taking an aspirin. Sometimes if you have a fever, taking an aspirin can be quite a pleasant thing to do. But I'd be curious to know from the audience, with a show of hands, how many people feel that Europe today lives with too much debt and perhaps with too much guilt, too much of this debt sin in Europe, or how many would feel that perhaps a few more aspirins are necessary in order for the hangover not to be too severe after so many years of excessive borrowing. And perhaps in a show of hands, I may ask how many in the audience feel Europe has too much debt today? So, and how many would feel the opposite, perhaps that Europe has the need of a number of more aspirins before it can face the hangover? Okay, so after the introductory comments of the governor, perhaps people are being a little bit cautious. But I bring here today three very distinguished panelists who bring a historical perspective, because of course borrowing is nothing new. Borrowing is as old as mankind itself. And I'll start with Luc Catau, who is at the moment in Vienna, and a experienced academic who has studied this subject for very many years. While sipping coffee in Vienna now, he will soon, however, return to Washington, to the International Monetary Fund, an institute which used to be somebody nobody wanted to hear from, but which more and more countries, including my own Ireland, are getting increasingly used to having dealings with. And I'll pass, also would like to introduce to Tom Grenes, who is an experienced academic from the United States, who brings with him very interesting perspectives on how the US has dealt with its debt bubbles in the past, and interestingly how the latest debt hangover in the US is not quite lifting as a previous debt in the wake of previous wars has done. Tom also has a lot of experience of Riga, where he's been traveling for many years, teaching in the Stockholm Economic School here. He said originally some of his students who came, because it's an English-speaking school, hadn't you know, had just embarked on learning the language, and many of them had picked up their English skills from MTV, so I'm not sure if he can use the same kind of language he used to persuade this generation about the perils of debt and sometimes the impact of a debt hangover. And of course, introducing who's had perhaps the longest journey, Kenichi, who has come all the way from Japan. Japan is a personal hobby interest of mine. Debt there has reached 230%, if I'm correct, of national output now, which means that Europe perhaps has a little way to go before it further gets to Japan stage. And interesting, he brings some interesting perspectives about the aging of society and how this aging of society is perhaps the real problem. And of course, aging societies is one that we know very well in Europe as well. I'd like to also invite the audience. You have the opportunity, unfortunately, before I proceed, Lucretia, who was due to attend today, will not be able to attend because of an emergency. That shouldn't prevent us from having a lively discussion about this interesting issue. And you have the opportunity to tweet using the Quo Vadis hashtag, Quovadis hashtag. With that, I can see your questions, but of course, perhaps a little bit more human as well. You can raise your hand, and there's people who will be able to give you a microphone, because it would be nice if we could get an interactive discussion going with the audience. And I believe there are some students here. I think students are typically the ones who hold people and institutions to account, so it would be great to see some of that here today. Perhaps I would like to start with you, Luis, for your perspectives on the history of debt, somebody who has experience of countries from Ireland to Uruguay, which is quite a perspective. In Ireland, we have the debt, but not the same climate. Yeah.
Good morning. Thanks for coming. Thanks for the government instance to invite, and the Central Bank of Latvia to invite me. It's actually my first time in Riga, so I'm very much looking forward to knowing a little bit more of the city, which hopefully I'll have time sometime today. Also, I should say right up front that, as John mentioned, I am currently on leave from the IMF, so I'm in Vienna until the end of the year, and all the things that I'm going to say here are my personal opinions, do not necessarily reflect IMF policy, the opinions of the IMF, its boards, its the management, as well as the opinions of the JVI. But I'm very happy to take your questions and try to share with you what I know about the subject. My first instinct when a topic like this, which is a big topic, I mean, is public debt, the high public debt, what's the impact on growth, is a big topic in economics, a big topic now. It's not a new topic, has been going on for quite a while. My first instinct when I see big topics like this is to go back to history, to say, well, what history tells us about, you know, experience with big debts and the links between debt and growth. And a first line of attack when you look at this question is, what is a high debt? Right? So what I did in the thinking about this conference was actually to go back to a database that the IMF nicely put together on public debt for a variety of countries going back to the 19th century. It's available online. You can tap this database, look at it, study the countries you want, and do all kinds of calculations. It was a very nice effort. What I did was basically to plot an average across countries and over time of public debt over GDP. And look at the average. And the average is roughly, you know, sort of about around 50% take and give, right? So if you just take this as just a very rough benchmark, right? You'd say, well, anything above 50% or 60%, say, is high from a kind of a broad historical perspective, right? However, when you actually start looking at these figures and break down by country groups and periods and so on, you see that this average has to be taken with a little bit of a pinch of salt, because there's been periods of high debt accumulation, for example, during the wars, the First World War, the Second World War. And there were periods also in which there was relatively fast deleveraging, that's to say the reduction of the debt to GDP ratio. For example, in the 1950s and 60s, the world economy was growing fast, so that was a period in which a lot of countries reduced their public indebtedness. So that was my first take at the data. A second take of the data actually doesn't come from my own analysis, but it comes from analysis of the World Economic Outlook, the document that the IMF puts out twice a year. If you go back to the 2012 October issue of the World Economic Outlook, which is available online as well, you see that there is a fascinating analysis of episodes of high debt in advanced countries. So emerging markets are taking out of that sample, so it's just, the sample just covers advanced countries. And you'll be surprised, at least I was surprised when I first read that chapter, that of the 22 countries, advanced countries, that they had data going back all the way to the 19th century, more than half had at least one episode, I repeat, of in debt to GDP ratio that was above 100%. So first conclusion of this, just on the basis of this plain fact, is that it's not, what we are facing today is not an unusual experience from the point of view of pure point of view of history, right? So that's the first cut, and then you say, well, you know, what do these episodes tell us, right? And again, another cut at the data is that you know, basically there was, after the debt to GDP reached that threshold, there was some effort to actually try to reduce it. So and there was, on average, some success in reducing it. And some success, there was gradual deleveraging, the gradual reduction of debt rate. Again, the experience of countries vary quite a bit. There are very different countries in the sample, and maybe in our discussion we'll cover some of that, what these different experiences tell us. But the basic point is that it seems from that analysis that no country was very happy to stay, or at least very comfortable to stay, with a debt to GDP ratio which was at that level. So there was an effort. How did this come about? How did the leverage take place? It takes place mainly through a combination of three things. One is primary balances turning to positive. That's to say, there was an effort to improve the primary fiscal balance, right? Often they turn into positive and substantially positive numbers. Two, the successful experiences have been often, not always, but often, associated with prolonged periods of monetary loosening. Monetary policy turned very accommodative, and that was that allowed some reduction in debt service, and that facilitated, allowed, fostered growth, that facilitated the leverage. And thirdly, not to take much of my time at this stage, there was growth. GDP growth, both nominal and real. Now, you switch on, you know, the sort of the tunnel, time tunnel, and then you are back to today, and you see that the first element is broadly there. There's been an effort in the past 2, 3, 4 years, after a rise in primary deficit in much of the advanced world, to actually bring primary balances into surplus, or at least improve the primary balances. There has been, as the governor was saying, a period of very loose, accommodative monetary policy. We are very, very low, unprecedentedly low historical interest rates. So what's missing in all this, so to speak, relative to the previous periods, is strong growth, both nominal and real. So I think that calls the question, which is really at the core of this conference, you know, how we are going to foster growth, and how that can help deleveraging. And I think these questions that are questions that to be discussed. I'd like to finish my initial introduction here. I just want to give this broad outline of the historical story behind what we are here to discuss today. So I'll pass it on.
Thank you. Perhaps with the challenge of growth, of course, a key to that is clearly getting banks to lend money again, which is perhaps one of the biggest difficulties that we have in Europe at the moment. But interestingly, of course, we've seen spikes in the past, and as you say, it's not unusual historically to have these spikes. This time around, however, the question is whether or not there's any way of recovering from the party. And Tom, I believe you have also witnessed and examined over time how previous spikes in the United States have come down sharply afterwards, but not this time.
Yes, thank you. Good morning. It's good to be here again. Especially impressed by the golden colors in Riga this time of year, and impressed by this this new structure. So we've been asked to talk about the relationship between government debt and economic growth. And I would say, first of all, there's no simple relationship there. One cannot say that bigger debt always results in slower growth. One cannot say that the opposite, bigger debt always results in faster growth. But rather, from empirical studies that put together high-income countries and low-income countries, what we usually find is a kind of threshold, debt threshold, some threshold such that if you get beyond it, the rate of economic growth goes down. If you start out below it and you stay below it, sort of nothing happens. So there's a kind of asymmetrical relationship involving these debt thresholds. So they've been estimated for a number of countries. One of the main things we know is that they vary by country. Not all countries are alike. And so for the high-income countries, the typical range of estimates for the threshold would be 75% of GDP up to 90% of GDP. We know that for lower-income countries, when they're separated out, it's the threshold is more like 60%. Some specific numbers we've already mentioned, the high ones, some high ones nowadays, Greece, of course, 177% of GDP, Japan, 246%, we'll hear more about this, Italy, 132%. At the other end of the spectrum, we've already heard a little bit, something about the Baltics, maybe it's something in the water here or the air. So you get, where are my numbers for the Baltics, 10% for Estonia, 38%, Latvia, 41%, Lithuania. So there is variation. Next one I would make about these thresholds is that persistence is very important. If you get above the threshold and stay there, problems arise. If you temporarily go above the threshold and get right back, essentially nothing happens. So having a high debt ratio per se, say for 1 year, is not necessarily a problem. Having a high debt ratio for 25 consecutive years usually means lower growth. And so let's see, in terms of this persistence, we have Greece being above 90% for 16 consecutive years, Italy for 27 consecutive years, Japan for 21 consecutive years. So not just high debt, but persistently high debt for these countries. And it's also true that these same countries have also experienced low growth. Next point related to thresholds would be, so if you know the threshold for your country, should you move your actual debt up to the thresholds? And say, no, not necessarily. It's a good idea to be well below the threshold. For example, if you're well below the threshold and you go into a recession, tax revenue falls. Budget deficit is bigger, debt goes up, so you can use countercyclical fiscal policy without getting beyond the threshold. Sweden has been a very successful case of this, which they, following a crisis back in the 1990s, they adopted some major reforms and they've got their debt down to 47%, and they've also adopted a balanced budget requirement over the business cycle. So I'm certainly not saying if a country is now at 40% and the threshold is 60%, you should jump up to 60%. No, it's probably not a good idea. Now, this idea of a debt threshold, it shows up in the statistical literature. Not everybody is persuaded, however. There's this high correlation between debt and economic growth. In which direction does it go? And so is it that the high debt is causing the slow growth, or is it the opposite? The slow growth is causing the high debt. And the reason for the latter, or the possibility of the latter, is business cycles. So when a country naturally they fall into a recession, that's the time when, so they say, tax revenue falls and the debt goes up. So it's, there's surely some causation in both directions. My reading is, however, that most of the causation is going from debt to growth. Why do I say that? A number of studies looking at the so-called debt overhang, and this is coming from Carmen Reinhardt and various co-authors, define a debt overhang as a period of 90% debt or higher relative to GDP for at least 5 consecutive years. So somebody who goes up there and stays up there for a long time, and the results, if you look at all these episodes over 200 years, yeah, going back to 1800, the high debt have grown more slowly by more than a percentage point per year than the low growth countries. And the other point is that the countries that have gone up above 95% generally stay there for long periods, 10 to 20 years, which is substantially longer than any business cycle recession. So next point I want to make is, so there's no single threshold for all countries. Sometimes policymakers like to ask economists, why don't you give me the number? Give me the precise number, like 79.2, that we can use for all time and for all countries. And unfortunately, it doesn't exist. And the main reason is countries differ substantially. Over time, they change. They're different across countries. And for example, take one country. So can you have a stable debt ratio for a threshold for one country? Well, take a country like, well, where are we now? In Latvia. Think of the fiscal policy. How has fiscal policy been made in Latvia? Is there any stability over the years? And you would say, well, the last 25 years, Latvian fiscal policy has been made essentially in Riga. Before that, largely in Moscow. Before that, the period between world wars, again in Riga. Go back before World War I, Russian Empire. So the decisions been made by very different groups, very different people, and probably brought about big changes. If you take another country like Germany, you would say today the fiscal policy made in East Germany today is very different from what it was when East Germany was separated from Germany as a whole. Very different from what happened in 1920 when Germany financed its budget deficits by printing money. So things change over time in a given country. Thresholds change. And of course, big differences across country in terms of income differences, with what the richest EU countries are 3 times as rich as the poorest ones, differences in financial markets, et cetera. You could say more about this later. The other issue I think that is important and problematic is the question of moral hazard, which I illustrate by referring to Greece. And so the basic idea here is if Greece is the only one who repays Greek debts, there's a certain probability that certain riskiness for Greek debt. If the second case, it's either Greece or somebody else in the EU who repays Greek debts, the riskiness of that Greek debt changes. And if you add one more possibility, maybe the IMF will bail out Greece, again, the riskiness of the Greek debt changes. What has happened in the case of Greece is some great uncertainty about this bailing out. Yes, we bail out. No, we won't bail out. And it's become very, the so-called troika and the vagueness of their commitments, maybe we bail out, maybe we don't, has added to uncertainty. It's probably made the recovery slower and probably higher cost. Maybe I say a little bit more about this. They mentioned the EU institutions. And so in some cases, I think the EU institutions have made it more difficult. A, they have changed some rules. And one is, I think, that began with saying each country is responsible for its own debts only, something like the United States. But then that seemed to change very quickly, and others are responsible for Greek debts. In other cases, they seem to just ignore certain rules, such as 60% is a maximum debt-GDP ratio. As was mentioned before, most Eurozone countries now have debts far in excess of 60%. Germany and France have been above 60% for 10 straight years. So I think that's a bit of a problem. Let me just mention the U.S. states, and I can come back if people are interested. I think when the Eurozone began, there was a notion that it would be something like the United States fiscal system, in which the federal government in Washington is not responsible for the state debt at all. However, things have changed in Europe. Things have not changed in the United States. The United States has lots of fiscal problems, and one of them is not bailing out of the states. So since 1790, the federal government in Washington has never bailed out a state, even though in the 1840s, several states defaulted on their debt. In the 1930s, several states defaulted on their debt. Recently, some major cities, including Detroit, have defaulted on their debt. So there is a difference there. I think I should skip ahead and just make one more point, and that would be, so the debt we're talking about so far is all the government debt. This is explicit bond debt by governments, i.e., they promise to pay a fixed amount of money at a fixed date in the future. This is not the only debt, and in most countries it's not the most important debt. So-called contingent debt is far more important, and this involves things like promises, somewhat vague promises to pay, pensions, and medical costs for retirees. This so-called contingent debt is bigger, certainly for the United States bigger. I think it's also bigger for Europe. For example, in the United States, the public debt is something like $18 trillion, and the unfunded Social Security debt is two times as big, and the unfunded Medicare debt is four times as big. And this of course, is related to demography, the aging of the population, and we can perhaps come back to that. In fact, I'm sure our next speaker is going to talk about demography and aging. So.
Hey, Tom, I'd like to put one question which I have in from the audience. And of course, it's not an exact science, but what is the level of debt, or perhaps if there's no one level of debt to GDP, then the range of level of debt to GDP, where the private sector borrowing is crowded out and basically growth stops? Your point was, of course, that is not a simple question to answer, but if you were to hazard a guess, where do you think it may be? Or is it a question of time?
Why didn't someone start with a simple question? Yeah. So, of course, it's difficult. So the thresholds vary by country. And the question is, well, what about my country? What is the ratio? And so I think what is needed is more country study, country-specific information, because countries do differ very substantially. And so here's we have room for researchers at the Bank of Latvia and other Latvians for looking for Latvia's optimal position. Also, there's been some discussion recently about fiscal councils, or more than discussion, fiscal councils, and I think in the EU, the Eurozone at least, every country now has some kind of a fiscal council, which in various cases means some outside group, outside of the government, sometimes academicians, who are thinking about these issues, studying these issues, trying to come up with numbers that relate to a threshold for a specific country. So I think that would be a useful piece of information. Nevertheless, let us not forget that questions about spending money and taxing people are ultimately unavoidably political. And so you can't avoid the argument that there'll be a party in one country that wants to have more spending, and there'll be another party in another country that have smaller spending, and probably some disagreement about debts as well. So I wish I could be more precise, but I think it's going to have to be more studies, more specific studies of the institutions, political and economic, of particular countries.
So it depends very much on the country, and you won't hazard a guess as to what it might be? I mean, if you've borrowed as much as you can produce and beyond, is that surely not problematic?
Yeah, it's. I can say that based on the statistical evidence I know, so the threshold, average thresholds for low-income countries are substantially lower than for high-income countries. So I mean, that's one point. To go beyond that, it's hard, because you'll say, so Sweden has developed this so-called debt break, as some other countries have also. So do you have a debt break or not? If you do, then you probably have some confidence that you will run a surplus during expansionary periods, you'll have a debt during other periods, and probably the optimal debt will be something like Sweden's come to 40%. If you don't have that debt break in place, you may have a quite different optimal level for debt.
But the poorer you are, the less you should borrow, which sounds like an old rule. A question also from the audience to you, Lewis, and that's what is the point of making the comparison with history when what we're seeing today is unprecedented monetary policy easing, printing of money on an unprecedented scale? I think the point of the participant was that you were saying history shows this isn't unusual. He's contradicting. You know, we've never seen this scale of money printing before. Surely that's kind of thrown the rule book out the window.
Well, I think the point is here that you want to try to look at parallels because you are looking at how successfully leverage took place in the past, right? So you want there is the sort of money easing of today, which is unprecedented. By the way, there were in the past also periods of low inflation and money easing. But you want to look at the elements. So you want to use history to actually say, well, how much in this situation you rely on that instrument versus that other instrument and so on. So, I'm of the view that we often learn from these experiences in the past. And this is also true in a broad sense of things. We learn from our experience in life, right? Even though the experiences are not the same. So it's a question of magnitude rather than qualitative difference. But if I may, I would like to add a couple of points to Thomas' answers, which is on the level of debt which is appropriate for countries. So I think there are a couple of things that we can think of that I think are important. First of all, what's the tax revenue ratio? How much taxation you already have? That's to say, in a gross sense of things, look at the ratio of government revenues to GDP, assuming that more than 50% of it, as it's reasonable, comes from taxes. How much more taxes are the citizens willing to take? I mean, in macroeconomics, I'm sure many of you have heard of the Laffer curve, which is the point in which, if you increase tax rates, you start collecting less. I mean, estimates of the Laffer curve are very controversial. Some people say that the peak of the Laffer curve when it's counterproductive to increase taxes is reached at 40%, others 50% or 70%. So, it's something that you have, as a politician, as a policymaker, you have to have a sense, and it's very difficult sometimes for an outsider to actually have a sense of this. So when you are in the process of negotiating adjustment programs, you have a sense because you hear from the policymakers, you hear from society and so on. So it's very difficult, but I think it's an important element. And again, going back to history, one difference that we have today relative to previous history, and we don't have to go very far in history, is that tax rates are pretty high. I was doing again a very simple comparison, divided total government revenues over GDP. Which is a broad indicator of how much the government collects from society to pay its debts, its finance its expenditures. And in the 1960s and 70s, in a number of advanced countries, were something like 35, 36, maybe 40%. And these numbers today are a lot higher. For the EU average, I believe, more or less, we are approaching 50%, 46, 47%. You can look at these numbers online. So, so you have to ask yourself, can you increase indebtedness so that you have to pay the debt one day? So for that, you need taxes. And if you are going to rely on taxes that distortions people's actions, so-called distortionary taxation, this may take a toll on growth. So you have to find your tax limit, I think is one thing. And the other, my final point about how to think about what's the leverage, the debt to GDP ratio that you'd feel comfortable with, is what do you do with the debt? So if you go back to the past and remember an old paper that I read when I was a student, these things when you read when you're a student, can last forever, is a paper by a development economist called Albert Fischler. And Fischler made this very simple point, which I thought was quite important. He said, in the past, going back to the pre-war period, right, countries borrowed a lot. There were episodes of high indebtedness. But a lot of it was to finance infrastructure. Went into public investment. So, that, in a sense, was generating income going forward. Once that investment matures and the economy becomes more productive and so on, it's easier to pay debt, right? And then you go and look at what's been happening to public investment since the 1960s and 70s in advanced economies, and in the EU in particular. And you see that it's on a downward trend. And this is not a preserve of the last few years. It's been a long-standing trend. So, so you have to look at indebtedness in broad context. Tax revenues, a percentage of GDP, are historically high. public investments, a percentage of government expenditure on GDP are low. So, you know, how much more can we do to increase debt? So I just wanted to add these two elements.
An audience member says, Europeans, they're basically stuck in the mud. They can't change their business models or modernize. This is a criticism that you hear a lot in Europe. The Europeans are very critical of it, of themselves, and of course from the United States we have a lot of criticism. Be very interested to turn to you, Kenichi, to hear about your experience in Japan. Are the Europeans the only ones with these problems? Apparently not, right?
Yes. Well, thank you for introducing me, and also thank you for inviting me here. A very interesting and important conference, and obviously I'm also first time come here in Latvia, or any Baltic countries actually. It's a great, nice city. I just took a walk yesterday. And on regarding Japan, just before that, I just briefly mention on unconventional monetary policy issues a bit. And actually, we know a bit confusing because, well, what the definition of the money is also quite difficult issue, actually. But in terms of printing money, money in circulation, we don't see much going up in as far as I know, in Federal Reserve Bank in US, Bank of Japan, or ECB, I guess. But looks like what's going on is that more and more excessive reserve, kind of deposits coming from private sector banks into central bank, and central bank kind of using that money to buy government bonds, mostly. But in some countries, like a little bit in the US, and then BOJ still doing, is also buying, in Japan's case, it's buying stocks, stock ETF in the stock exchange. It's a private company stock, as well as REIT. REIT is a real estate investment trust fund, which is invested to the real estate, similar to also MBS purchase from the Federal Reserve previously. So some say central bank is actually not really printing money in circulation, but it's really doing more like hedge fund operation using you know, public status. Of course, it's quite questionable issue, especially if a central bank buying private sector related instruments like BOJ or Fed. That's one point. On the fiscal side, yes, I would like to explain what Japan is. And obviously, Japanese researchers has been struggle to find out any effect on fiscal policy. And I know we don't really have a good answer. As you, as John said, our debt to GDP ratio is about 230. Some estimates say it's mostly it could be already reached to 250%. But anyway, by no means in historically reasons or historically or cross country comparisons, I believe Japan is right now its highest debt to GDP ratio in the world. Well, in Japan's own history, that I believe we just surpassed or almost the same as almost end of World War II, which, you know, it's quite devastating in our country everywhere. And we know past 70 years we didn't have any war. So this is not really related, nothing related to war-related expenditure. It's solely in a peaceful time we reached 230% debt to GDP ratio. It's probably first time in history. And let's say, I would like to comment on whether I can say something on European countries, if I can say anything about the lessons from Japan. First of all, currently, Japan has recently has been in, I would say, economy is supply constraint, because our unemployment rate is quite low, about 3%, and then even at the height of 1990s, so-called we call crisis period, our unemployment rate is just a bit above 5%. And capacity utilization is also showing similar kind of picture. That means, I would say Japanese economy is really supply-side constraint rather than demand-side constraint, which, you know, the Keynesian policy usually can work on a demand-constraint economy to push up demand to meet the some given supply level. But our economy looks like, at least recently, more like supply-side problem, not really demand-side. So I don't, therefore, I don't see any reason for Japan to push for, to adopt for more Keynesian-style policy. Of course, in Europe, I know some countries' unemployment rate is quite high, with also some migration issues coming in. So I do see maybe there's some chance that demand-stimulating Keynesian policy may work in Europe. However, I would like to caution European countries in two fronts from Japanese experience. One, as Tom mentioned, is a structural problem because of aging society. I would say fiscal crisis would be inevitable without continuous fiscal reform if the society is aging. And then second one is the government needs to be careful to assess the output gap. Whenever Keynesian people say Keynesian policy needed, it's against a negative output gap. So output is a little bit lower than potential. That's why Keynesian people sometimes saying we need some demand stimulation there. But you have to be careful about how to assess that. Because, you know, a seemingly deep recession after a boom, sometimes it's not really so deep recession. Actually, it may be the case growth trend just became lowered. So the, in that case, it's actually the trend lowered, not really potential growth rate has lowered, not really there's output negative gap. So you have to be careful about these two, because if the trend lowered, then that's the reason for the low growth, then the Keynesian style demand stimulating policy wouldn't work. That's, and then regarding that, actually Japanese, well, I first explain what these two points means. In Japan, the second point, in Japan, after the bubble burst of early 1990s, our stock price, the highest point was end of 1989 or early 1990, and the land price, real estate price, reached the height 1991. So it's, that's 90 or 1991 is the height of bubble, and then it burst. And after that, for several years, Japanese government spent on public works quite largely, and that's a typical Keynesian policy. However, the output gap used in justifying such Keynesian policy turned out to be wrong. With the long historical data, researchers, we now know that the end of Japanese bubble period, end of 1980s, coincided with the end of high growth rate, which was possible because Japanese economy is in a catch-up growth process towards the frontier economy like the United States. But at that point, our growth trend became lowered, which we now know. So, however, right after the bubble burst, no one knew that low growth rate was a new trend. Instead, many people attributed the low growth rate is a temporary recession and deep recession, and that's why the government poured excessive spendings into public works as an And as a result, Japan's fiscal situation has got into a disaster, I believe, much faster than it should have. Much faster meaning I would like to explain the first point about aging problem. I believe the aging of the society is really a kind of automatic destabilizer which naturally causes a fiscal crisis. Because without continuous fiscal reforms, the tax revenue obviously declines and social expenditure increases. Because we have more pensioners. Pensioners don't pay income tax, but receive pensions. And there are more pensioners compared to young people. Obviously, tax revenue just declining while social spending going up a lot every year. So, indeed, Japan's prime balance has never been positive since the end of bubble burst, 1990-91. And however, compared to that 1990 budget and the current budget, tax revenue is almost actually okay to the GDP ratio basis, and expenditure not related to aging is almost the same. What has been increased in the expenditure side, which make budget not balancing, is that aging-related pension expense and medical subsidies. So, obviously, we have to deal with this with a continuous fiscal reform. That's my
The aging of society is perhaps at the root of this problem, and that's something, getting old is something that no one has managed to successfully avoid. When it comes to Japan and its constantly expanding debt, you left to fly over here, people were getting up to go to work in the morning and they were shopping in the evening. So what's the problem? I mean, really, if they continue to borrow, it seems to have worked for Japan. It seems to kind of contradict the idea that you shouldn't borrow. And of course, in this country, the discussion has been very much that one also should not borrow, but if everyone else is borrowing in the world, do you not run the risk that by not borrowing yourself, that people will borrow on your behalf and spend the money for you? But certainly in the case of Japan, I'd be curious to hear why is it not right for Japan to continue borrowing? When is the natural limit reached?
Well, the reason that Japan has been able to borrow is really reflected in a very low interest rate, the Japanese government bond. When issued, we still can borrow, it's less than 1%. I mean, long-term bond, probably 1.5 to 2%. In the short term, it's almost 0%. And then that comes from the fact that most of the government bonds are essentially, through the banking system, essentially purchased by the domestic people. Our holdings, Japanese government bonds, more than 90%, most likely about 95%, held by Japanese residents. And that's why we can still borrow. However, this can go on. But this is actually two issues. One is this can go on only until our national savings is positive to buy government bonds. But as I said, in aging meaning, age society meaning, although each household, if I look at the young generation, the older generation, their savings and consumption behavior is the same. But we have more and more pensioners who are dis-saving. Well, young guys still saving, but the number of pensioners just increasing compared to the number of young workers. So the overall national savings rate is on a declining trend, and reached right now it's almost zero, even negative, I see. And some point, some economists actually estimate, within 10 years, indeed, we can no longer purchase. I mean, Japanese people can no longer support the 100% purchase of Japanese government bonds. That would be the end of this story. We have to sell our bonds to the foreigners, and the question is, who is which, you know, foreign people, even right now, only 5% people, 5% of the domestic bonds bought by foreigners, and how we can sell it in the future is a huge, huge question. And second issue is that, in a sense, one of the ultimate resolution to get out from the debt, huge debt problem, is just declare bankruptcy, don't pay. That can be okay for Greek people because Greek debt is held by foreigners. They can say that. But problem with Japan is over 95% of the debt is held by Japanese people. The government cannot say we are declaring default. In a sense, low interest rate comes only from the, also from that point of view, because Argentina, Russia, we see if the debt is held by the foreigners, there's a strategic incentive for government to say I'm bankrupt, I'm default, even though they could actually potentially pay out. But they some point they believe declaring bankruptcy is better for the country. But in Japan, it's never so, because declaring bankruptcy, at least politicians don't want to do it. Declaring their own voters, it's impossible. And of course, if we do so, all the banking system gone bust, we have to recapitalize, then we have to issue bonds again. So we never have that ultimate option.
So if a government continue to borrow indefinitely by issuing bonds and selling them to your own citizens or corporations, eventually you stop people saving and this model unravels.
I would say people, young generation, still savings as before, but the problem is relative ratio of pensioners going up and up. So that's why the national savings, although each cohort savings rate is the same, but in the national savings, dropping. That's why this model cannot go in the future. Probably within 10 years, that wouldn't.
Yeah, and I think you mentioned as well in our earlier conversations that people in Japan would take a very similar view of debt to the feeling of guilt that a German might have in taking a loan. But unfortunately, a lot of people in Japan are themselves living frugally or modestly, but they don't realize that so much is being borrowed on their behalf, or perhaps they don't want to face up to that.
Yeah, as I said, in each cohort, each generation, behavior of savings are not so much changed. That's why they don't really see they indeed borrowed. But the problem is that aging problem, more pensioners, meaning just because pensioners, it's natural to dissave, to live on, because that's why they saved before. And we cannot really say against about that kind of behavior. So as pensioners' portion in the population going up, we will have trouble, while each person still not feeling guilt much. However, I have to say, many Japanese still worry a lot about fiscal situation.
Tom, a question to you, because we were talking about the natural level of debt. A number of people in the audience have asked whether or not the 60% debt to GDP ratio, which is stipulated in our European rules in the Eurozone, is it perhaps out of date? Well, I mean, it turns out very few people respect it anyway, but from those that still hold it up as a model of the economy, is it sensible still? Also bearing in mind just the levels of debt in the rest of the world, including in China, and it seems there's no corner of the world which hasn't discovered the enjoyment of taking out a loan.
Yeah, it's difficult because if you want to have a unified Europe, you think maybe I should have some same rules for everybody, some common rules. This goes against the idea that it seems that these debt ratios, the thresholds, are different for different countries because it's very different fiscal institutions. So you've got a kind of conflict there. And then the other one is, I think, more severe. I think more severe is that the rules seem to mean very little. When you have most countries violating rules for 10 straight years, the people making the rules and don't enforce them, they've lost their credibility. And they're a source of uncertainty. So this is the meaning of the 60% is extremely vague. And I think there's a sense in which people have pointed this out, so that it seems that the 60% only seems to be relevant for when you're joining. When you're on the outside, you must get below 60%. Once you get above that, oh, you can do what you want for 10 years or so. So I think that's a big problem, this problem of credibility and uncertainty. And I think the whole system would benefit from simpler, more understandable rules that are enforced regularly. Now, if this means not 60% for everybody, then that's, of course, a contradiction.
So perhaps the rule in itself is only degraded by the fact that nobody respects it? I mean, is it, apart from that, a sensible rule, or is it even good to have written down as a goal?
Yeah, I think for me, so I have a simple mind, I'm a simple-minded person, I like simple rules, and so if you could go back and start the euro system again, which we cannot, if you could go back, I like the idea that, like the American one, that each country is responsible for its own debts. Only Greeks are responsible for Greece. If that were the case, there would be no reason to have a 60% rule. If Greece goes to 80% and defaults, let them default, as South Carolina did and Georgia did. But you can't go back and do that. So I think that's part of the problem, that the system is kind of, I think, if you like it, you could say it's evolved toward greater centralization. If you don't like it, you say that Europe is stumbling and staggering toward greater centralization. But I think that's the problem.
Yeah. Just to mention again to the audience that you can feel free to raise your hand. I do get a lot of the questions here on my tablet here when I can see what people are tweeting, but please do feel free to challenge or pose a question. I think that the issue of productivity, an audience member says that perhaps Japan is an example that even with high improvements in productivity, an economy can't grow with an aging society. Has there been these improvements in productivity in Japan, and is it true that Japan has to more or less make do with flatlining indefinitely?
Economic growth side, if you look at GDP growth, real GDP growth rate in Japan, yes, it's kind of flattening past 15, 20 years. And however, our population growth is negative, especially if you look at working age population, which is 15 years old to 64, 65 years old guys. This population is negative quite a lot in the past 15, 20 years. So if you adjust that, if you adjust not just GDP, real GDP growth rate, but if you look at per capita real GDP growth, or even better, real GDP growth per working age population, and if you compare that number of Japanese number to other countries like United States, in at least since year 2000, at least past 15 years, even before the crisis or even after the crisis, our number is almost the same as the United States, or even better. As far as I remember, from 2000 to 2006 or 7, like 6-7 years, per working age population GDP growth rate, real one, is about 2%, which is quite good compared to US. It's about the same in US. So I would say, actually, despite this huge debt, and despite the fact that our fiscal side operation, at least since late 1990s, is mostly just social spending, not really a Keynesian policy, despite the fact that huge fiscal debt, productivity growth has been quite good. Only problem is really a demographic negative contribution to the total GDP. And therefore, going back to also fiscal reform, looks like fiscal, so-called, we have been partially done the fiscal reform, and many people recognize more fiscal reforms comes. Still, the productivity growth kept quite same as like United States level. So I would say kind of anecdotally showing fiscal reform or expectation of fiscal reform is not so much negatively affected in Japanese economy. And what I say is the growth become lower because up until 1980s, our growth rate, like 3 or 4% in the real growth per capita GDP, that became 2%, which is comparable to the frontier economy like US. That's why we say it's lower. But the politicians at that time, in the early 1990s, thought that Japanese economy should grow like 3 or 4%, which is just not possible because our economy reached to the almost frontier of the league of the OECD countries. Right?
Tom, I think you wanted to come in there.
Yes, Kenichi makes an important point. He says that aging is an automatic destabilizer, which makes me a bit nervous and probably makes Europeans nervous. Europeans are aging, Americans are aging, Chinese are aging. If aging by itself is an automatic destabilizer, of course, it's difficult to stop. You can have more immigration, perhaps, but is there a better way of funding pensions that would make it less of a destabilizer?
Speaking, this is not the subject of the conference, but given that one of the key sources of debt globally is also the aging population, is there a case to be made for immigration? I don't think it's necessarily worked in the case of Japan. It's not necessarily part of the formula there. How perhaps has it worked in the United States? Has it helped resolve any of these difficulties?
As far as I know, the immigration in U.S. is really helping a lot. Because if I look at the working age population growth when I did this exercise, U.S. Is actually lots of young workers migrate into U.S. That's helping a lot about total GDP growth and helping a lot on the fiscal side, I believe. While Japan is the opposite side. That's the issue. And then about how to change the pension system to be consistent with aging society is something we are struggling. I know that many countries struggling, and Japan is struggling too. At least we introduced a kind of macro indexed system very recently so that pension expenditure to GDP ratio has a kind of ceiling. So that, however, reality meaning every year the pension money become lower and lower. So at some point, the problem was whether the pensioners can be satisfied with that. It more become a political question in the future.
Lewis, perhaps a question to you, and this touches on something we discussed earlier on, and that is whether or not, if you're paying a very low rate of interest, whether or not it's you, as many salesmen would tell you, you simply can't afford not to take the credit. If the credit is so cheap that it's effectively for free, is it not a foolish decision to turn that up? That's a question from a member of the audience.
Well, going back to why countries borrow, right? I think that's important to have in mind. Why countries borrow? They can borrow for productive reasons, for less productive reasons. But at the end of the day, they will have to pay off the debt. And one way in which you pay off the debt is to increase tax, right? So when you increase tax, these taxes are distortionary. So you may end up getting an interest rate which is zero. But you have to pay back the principal, if at a zero interest rate. So for that, you have to raise taxes or you have to raise resources somehow. If this is the raising resources is distortionary, that should say you end up to taxing productive people. It depends on how you do it, and there are many ways you can do it, but one way is to distortionary taxation. Then you end up worse off because you are going to impose taxes on people who are productive, who at the end of the day would be, if they were not taxed, they would be producing more. So even though the interest rate may be zero, you may be better off in those cases of not taking up that debt, because at the end of the day, when you have to pay it, you're going to have to actually lose output to pay. But if I could, I want to get back to the question of migration, which I think is fascinating for many reasons. If you are a kind of an economic historian leaning person, you may. But I think two points I think are worth mentioning, and it's very much outside my own expertise and the expertise the institutions I work for. But you know, I think there are two points here. One of them is that who are you taking? In the sense, what's the working age of the person you are taking? So if you are taking immigrants who are, you know, in the sort of the working age population, as Kenichi was mentioning, then there are two things with this. One is that you gain, in the sense that you can actually get human capital and so on. But it depends on what you're going to provide the person also, right? Because there are social benefits and so on. But another consideration that crossed my mind as Kenichi was speaking was that that depends on the saving ratio of your country, right? So if you get people in the working age as immigrants, let's say people in the age between 25 and 60, right? So that pumps up the saving ratio of your country, right? Because these people will save for their retirement later. Now, is the problem of your country a low saving ratio? I can think of the United States as being a country in which the saving ratio is not particularly high. So, you know, you may want to pump up the saving ratio. But I can also think of countries where the saving ratio is pretty high as it stands. So the problem is not too much savings. Actually, the problem is too little savings. You know, you want people to actually save less and invest more. So I think this consideration is important. Immigration patterns have to be somehow, to my mind as an economist, tailored to what you want to achieve, right? And I think the saving decision is an important one.
I have a question here from somebody in the audience called Oleg Matveyev. I'm not sure if I understand it correctly, so if you're out there, please feel free to grab a microphone and explain it, but I also understand if you'd perhaps like to leave it at the tweet. But it is concerning the emigration of a savers generation from Latvia. So we're talking about larger areas in smaller countries where there is a great mobility of the workforce, as there is in this country, and where you're living within a wider economic bloc, the European Union. What is the potential downfall, Tom, if some of these savers depart and leave for elsewhere? Does that erodes and complicates the debt question further?
Yes, that's a difficult one. That's sort of the opposite of the one we see in the United States, where we've had substantial immigration, which has made this aging population smaller. If you have emigration, it's serious. I imagine this gets back to the question we raised with regard to Kenichi, and that is to say, how do you finance this Social Security? So if it's all you promise large benefits to people and you underfund them while they're working, then when the young people leave, then you have a serious problem. So I think that perhaps changing the way that people pay for Social Security or change the structure of the benefits, that would help a bit. But that's not easy. That's painful, of course. But that may be one solution.
Louis, this is a dilemma as well, which I presume it's a dilemma that faced my country, Ireland, in the past also. A small mobile workforce and many people left, obviously, they're the last people you want to see leaving. It leaves behind, as we have in many towns in Germany, purely people who are older and with little young people to drive the dynamic of the workforce. Do you have a solution, a formula that can resolve this?
I wish I had.
Yeah.
I really don't. And as I said, it's not my speciality. My simple point I was trying to make before is that one has to be conscious as a policymaker, I think, of what you want to achieve. You know, the saving element is important, and it's also important what you're going to offer in terms of benefits to the immigrants and so on. And I think both for humanitarian reasons as well as for economic reasons. So I think these are very complicated considerations. Mm-hmm.
Another question from the audience to you on Japan and the participation of women in the workforce, and the question being whether or not this further participation of women in the workforce could be the answer to Japan's debt problem.
Yes, indeed. For Japan, that's quite discussed a lot. Because Japan's women's labor force participation rate among the lowest, lowest among the OECD countries. And obviously, we see half of the population is women, so we see lots of potential over there, and try to find out what's really prohibiting those female population, women, working, which turns out there are several issues, but in the biggest issue, one biggest issue is it's really shortage of babysitting services, shortages of the you know, kindergartens and so on, because women have little kids, have to find a place to take care of their kids, and then they can come to work. But that has been a problem. It's the same problem as, I would say, elderly person. It's very difficult in Japan to find out nursing homes, and very difficult to find nurses. That's why I'm saying it's a supply constraint, especially constraint on nurses and babysitters and those people. That's where then the immigration policy side, we are hugely discussing on, at least we should be opening up on this particular people, because just next to, just south of Japan, we have Philippines and Thailand, Indonesia, which those countries are very well known of the exporters of nurses and babysitters in the world, into the world. And we are currently almost closing that channel. So at least we should be opening up for that. And still, we are kind of very slightly opening up, but not really in a serious sense yet. And that's where hugely debated right now in Japan.
Yeah. Looking through the tweets here, the theme is emerging also of central banks, and again, coming back to the point that if you borrow, well, you will get bailed out essentially by the central bank. If money is losing perhaps its value, then it would be perhaps foolish not to borrow. I've been struck by the fact that banks were very weakened in the crisis, but now it seems to be pension funds and insurers, the effectively the holders of our pensions, who are suffering in the wake of the monetary policy post-crisis. I'm curious to know, Lewis, when is the moment at which central banks should stop helping and allow the market to function as it was originally intended, and perhaps allow money to function as it was intended originally, which was a means of fair exchange for goods and services?
So let's look at this, at what central banks in many countries want to achieve. We increasingly, over the past 15 years or so, we moved to an inflation targeting regime, certainly in the Eurozone, then gradually in the US, and in many other countries, that's the regime. So we want to ideally achieve in the long run a rate of inflation of, say, you know, in current terms, something like 2%. So in order to achieve 2%, the instrument that you have is interest rate. So, you know, until that target is in the horizon back again, you know, it's just natural that you want to lose monetary policy and you want to actually use the instruments that you have at your disposal to achieve 2%. So the question is really, why is that goal of achieving 2% now so elusive? And that's the question we have to answer. And the other aspect that's related to this, which I don't feel competent enough to talk about because that involves a lot of political economy, which is that, you know, central banks, and we have here a central bank governor who can talk much more qualified way about this, is that central governments were overweighted, as I see, during the crisis, because sometimes, you know, fiscal policy is not as agile. So central banks were left with a lot of burden during the crisis of how to act. And if you have one or two instruments and you have to do this, it's just natural that you may try to do, you know, to go very far the direction you have. So I think the question, going back to your point, is the central banks want to achieve a 2% so that they have that instrument. So the question is, why is this goal so elusive? And I think the focus should be on that. Why inflation remains so low after this stimulus. Mm-hmm.
Tom?
Just a quick comment, is I think this is going to come to our next group. I think it's very important that central banks be independent than the finance ministry. And this is I think, written into the rules of the European Central Bank. They have an inflation goal, and they're expected to meet the inflation goal. They're not directly involved, or they should not be, I think, directly involved in bailing out countries. So they need some independence there to meet their inflation goal. That's the first. Second point is going to go back to some earlier questions. Well, it is true that central banks have been printing lots of money in the United States and the European community, but we haven't had inflation. I mean, the concern is inflation, printing money. I feel a little bit uneasy. My old professor, Milton Friedman, responsible for the quantity theory of money, if you print more money, you get more inflation. But so far, the problem in Europe and the U.S. is falling prices, not rising prices. So we have to look to the future, of course. There may be a lag between the printing and money and the inflation. But for the immediate problem seems to be not more inflation, but falling prices.
What benefits do you think that the quantitative easing program run by the European Central Bank has for a country like Latvia? Or does it bring any benefits? I mean, there are some critics who say that it is very beneficial for asset prices, such as on stock markets or on property prices. But when it comes to promoting growth, especially when the banking sector is so low on confidence and sitting on so many bad loans already, it's not very effective. I mean, does it offer benefit to a country like Latvia?
It's possible. So it's boosting aggregate demand. This is one of the difficult problems we mentioned earlier. So the labor markets in all the 19 member countries are very different. So we have extremely high unemployment rates in some 25% in some countries. Others we have very low, less than 5%. So trying to have an aggregate demand policy through monetary policy that's appropriate for all the countries, very difficult. And I'm not sure. Latvia may be benefiting some. But I suspect other issues related to economic growth are more crucial for Latvia.
But is there a contradiction then when the Baltic states pursue a policy of austerity when at the same time there is such a monetary loosening being pursued at the core of the Eurozone? Is there a contradiction and a potential difficulty in the future?
That's tricky. That's tricky for central bankers and for the people who make fiscal policy in individual countries such as Latvia. Yeah, that's a difficult issue.
Mm-hmm. And Lewis, I don't know if you have a view on that, whether or not there is a tension there that is created by the desire to respect the rules at a time when there is such a loose monetary policy.
You mean the fiscal rules?
The fiscal rules.
I mean, this is so country-specific that it's difficult because the experience has been very varied. It's difficult to come up with a generalization of this. But I would like to, if I may, come back to the fiscal rule in Europe, because sometimes, you know, and I'm not defending, you know, sort of mechanical fiscal rules, but we have to see a little bit what's behind it. I mean, behind the 60%, and I'm old enough to remember the discussions back in the 90s, you know, it's actually the numbers behind it are very sensible, right? So in order to stabilize debt at 60% of GDP, you can do that if you have a fiscal deficit of 3% and the economy grows at 5% in nominal terms. With an inflation target of 2 and growth of 3, you grow at 5% in nominal terms, so you can have a deficit of 3% of GDP. And then you can finance a debt, stabilize a debt at 60%. So that sounds, to me, a very reasonable ballpark calculation. The issue is that inflation now is close to zero. So growth is far away from three. So, you know, you can't make it do, right? So I think, again, we have to go back to the question of why inflation is so low. And to me, there are many pleasing facts there that I don't understand so well. A number of economists don't understand, and I think we really have to figure out what's going on there.
Well, one of the problems, I think, for low inflation is, it's often blamed on oil, but of course low wage price increases is a general issue, and I think the wage recovery in the United States has been poor as well. This points to a wider disparity, I suppose, between capital and the working population. Does this present also a difficulty, in particular in a high debt environment?
Yes, but I think it presents a difficulty. But again, it's not entirely clear how to get out of it. I'm not sure what my colleagues have. I think Kenishi has something to add on this, so I'll pass it on to him.
I have a bit different perspective. One on fiscal rules. Many countries have fiscal rules. The question is how we can implement it. For example, Japan, we have a public finance law the fourth article saying that Japan is not allowed to issue any debt to finance budget. Okay? And that public finance law has never been changed since World War II. Why we are still issuing bond is because past 40, 50 years, every year, our parliament passed the law saying this year is exception. Okay. So we never change the public finance law. The rule is clearly said the government is not allowed to issue bonds. However, every year has been exception somehow by determined by the parliament. So rule is important, but the way how to implement it is really more important than just making rules. That's the first point, which we are struggling, obviously, 40, 50 years, in a sense. And then price side, not quite. I also has been puzzling. As you know, that Japan has been almost zero negative inflation rate in past probably 20 years or 25 years actually, and with a massive quantitative easing, BOJ started even around 2000, way before any Federal Reserve or ECB started. BOJ started the year around 2000, even just before 1999 is probably the first year BOJ started QE. And then even before that, it's very low interest rates. And then at least in Japan's case, I have to say it's really related to wage issues. It's essentially related to opening up of more global trade issues, especially for us, it's China. Because China is next to us. And around 1990, their wage level is about 30 to 1. Our Japanese wage is probably more than 30 times of Chinese wage. And now, currently, China developed so rapidly, but still 10 to 1. Japanese income per capita is about 10 times high compared to China. But then they decided to open up early 1990s, obviously a tremendous effect coming to Japan as well as other Asian countries, I believe. Factories moving out a lot to China, and obviously without factory moving out, of course, just trade creates lowering pressure on the wage, as well as commodity price lowered a lot. And that we never have good formal analysis on it yet, but in the global scale, we have to think about those Brazil, China, India kind of issue, how they are affecting global prices. Especially currently, we know because of China and other emerging markets economy has actually become into the recession in a sense, so that we know oil price plunged, we know commodity price. That's what Mr. Kuroda, our BOJ governor, kind of saying, we tried to make 2% goal, but couldn't do it because huge plunge of oil price, which is actually a good thing to oil importers like Japan. We shouldn't be really complaining about it. But in terms of why we have a low inflation rate, it's so essentially solely because of commodity price movements in the past year or two.
Come towards the close of our discussion, I think one of the things that normally comes towards the closure of a debt is a default. I think one journalist said once that if you think nobody cares if you're alive, try missing a couple of payments on your car loan. And is it the fact that perhaps we need to make a clean breast of some of these debts. This also touches on the question of the cleansing of the banking system in Europe, where there has been some criticism of the stress tests and the manner in which we've attempted to be honest about the loans that we've given, which cannot be repaid. I think that applies to every country throughout Europe and many in the periphery as well. I know that in the United States they were a bit more upfront about their banking problems, but is it time to consider, Tom, a question of default? I know you pointed to the example last night of Detroit, where the court proceedings forced them to consider whether or not they needed to sell some of their art gallery holdings in order to pay back their debts. People in Europe typically don't like doing that, yeah? And it's become a problem that we don't face up to the debts we can't repay. Would default, if not on a state level, but perhaps on a personal level or a banking level, make sense in kickstarting Europe's economy?
Yeah, well, our topic today is government debt, which is quite different from private debt. So in private debt, we normally have some bankruptcy process in which you affirms all their assets and liabilities are taken into account. There's some orderly procedure in which everybody can't be paid, and judges decide who gets paid and who doesn't get paid. So here's the so-called private sector participation. Somebody loses. In the case of government debt, it's more complicated. So you can't go through this process. You can't seize the Parthenon in Greece, I don't think. And also, you get more of this bailing out, more of the bailing out issues in the government sector. So I would say, in general, with regard to default, if there would be less of the bailing out, if there were clearer rules about bailing out holders of government debt, yes, the private sector would play a bigger role. It would be default, but for some reason, it seems that important people in the EU have chosen not to take that route. And private sector losses seem to be always being protected by somebody.
Mm-hmm. Can you?
Yeah, my understanding is really for the sovereign debt, we now have a sovereign immunity that prevents any countries to seize the assets of sovereign nations. Right? That's based on bad experience. Pre-World War to pre-World War I kind of experience. That's why we do have now that kind of system, which we shouldn't really touch upon, because we don't want to colonize country because of that country is not paying back the debt. However, might be, especially in the European Union, within European Union, I am quite interested in actually hearing your views, because I do think in the European Union might need a little bit more systematic approach about sovereign bankruptcy. So it can establish, could it be possible to have a kind of sovereign bankruptcy court or something, rather than just ongoing current kind of ad hoc negotiation-based sovereign default resolutions?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, actually it's a topic that it's a little bit close to my heart right now, because we just finished with a colleague of mine in the IMF. We just finished some research on this. So we look at the cost of default, of sovereign default, which has been a very polemical cost. Some people, some researchers, some analysts say, well, you know, markets forget countries, forget defaults easily. So once you default, you face a high interest rate for 1, 2, 3 years, but then, you know, your interest rate seems to go back as if nothing had happened. And we actually took a very thorough look at the data, data across countries going back a long way, and so on. And we find that actually the cost is actually quite substantial. We found estimates. You can actually look at we have a little article online, the Vox EU, in which we summarize our results. But we find that the cost is something like, depending on the period, between 250 basis points, let's say 2.5% in addition of the interest rate you pay, that's an interest premium on top of this, and can go up to 400 basis points or 4%. So, I mean, default is not something that you should consider lightly, because it has its cost. But the other thing that we didn't show in our paper, but we have at the back of our calculations, is that what happens to debt to GDP ratio of countries at default? And we look at a number of episodes, and on average, in fact, even though defaulting principle reduces the debt, when we actually look at the debt to GDP ratio, you know, 5 years after the country goes back to the market, is that the debt to GDP ratio declines only, the decline is not big. So because default has such disruptive effects in general on GDP that the numerator falls, that's to say you reduce your debt, you don't pay whoever lend you, but also the denominator falls. So bottom line is that I think default is a kind of a last resort option. It is a serious, has serious implications for interest rate going forward, and I think countries should be very, you know, careful when they look at this.
Of course, in Europe, we do have a system, as you pointed out, Tom, where you can run up new debts, such as was the case, and it continues to be the case in Greece. You don't have to worry so much about default. But this, in turn, even though Greece has had its own defaults, partial defaults, complete default hasn't happened. But of course, this extend and pretend game carries a large cost as well for the image of Europe as a borrower in the world, I presume?
No, I think so, yeah. And I think having greater certainty, I mean, Louis's point is an important one, that the real GDP suffers substantially. You must take that into account. I think that's partly due to people's expectations. They're not knowing what's going to happen and what the outcome is. So if I can take the history of the United States, it should be clear to everybody that for 200 years, the federal government has not bailed out any state. Lots of states are in serious problems right now. The state of Illinois has a serious problem with regard to repaying or paying off their pensioners. Their bonds have been rated down by Moody's. There's no serious discussion of bailing out Illinois. And so I think if you have the institutions in place, people's expectations, and then Kenichi's point is that you actually carry them out, you actually implement the rules, I think that would make a difference.
Mm-hmm. Louis, you say that it simply does not pay into default, really. I mean, you were pointing out that it leads to increased borrowing costs, but that it could nonetheless possibly be an option, even if one that you would have to consider very seriously before taking that step. When and under what circumstances does it make sense to say we need to make a clean breast of it, and even despite the interruption this will cause us in borrowing costs and to GDP, we just have to do it because our debt is simply unmanageable? If we look at the case of Greece, for example, this may present a case in point, but there may be other candidates as well.
I think it's also important to distinguish what do you mean by default, right? There is default and there is default. So one default has to do with the fact that you restructure the debt, you come to an agreement with the creditors and you restructure the debt, just comes to the back of right off my mind, the experience of Uruguay in 2003. I was not working in Uruguay, I don't know the details and so on, but there was an agreement that was done in a difficult moment for the country, incredibly difficult moment, because the neighboring country had defaulted 1 or 2 years before. So, you know, so that's one default in which there is some loss, there is some haircut to the investors, but there is a negotiation which is kind of amicable, right? And there is a default that you just unilaterally don't pay. And I think this default where you unilaterally don't pay and you don't really have necessarily a plan going forward, right, is normally a very painful thing. And I wouldn't recommend this to countries as just an economist. So I think it's important to differentiate between these two episodes. I think what you probably have in mind is the first one, in which there is some rescheduling of debt, that's negotiated, and you say, okay, you know, we go forward on that basis.
Kenichi, with Japan's future burden of debt, further retiring pensioners, and it's already reached 230 or 40% of GDP. I mean, will Japan at any stage have to restructure its debt or consider that down the road?
It's as Luis said, and also it's clearly written in like Rogue of Reinhardt book too. There's a default on the financial, default on government bonds, that's a very clear-cut default. And there's a other default on other liabilities, which include someone government promised to, but not honoring it. That's also a default. It essentially comes in default on pension, default on public servants' wage. In terms of that, in a sense, Japan has been already in that case because our pension has been reduced gradually past 10 years. That obviously, for those pensioners' point of view, government is really reneging. It's not really honoring what they promised to them when they are contributing social security funds. And the public servant wage also, after this financial crisis 2009-10, about 1 or 2 years, indeed the government public servants have to take a 10% wage cut like that. So it's kind of default in a sense. It's something that is not written in the wage contract in the previous. Of course, we don't want to do either default. It's obviously where to go is only way to, as I said, government cannot default on their own people. Because, as I said, 95% is owned by our own people. So its only way is really a fiscal reform, which is lowering benefits or increased tax. And both sides, government is doing gradually, try to raise especially consumption tax gradually, and then try to lower the benefits gradually. We'll see how we can go.
Tom, perhaps I'll give you the last word.
Yes, yeah, so Kenichi's point is related to a point I made earlier about so-called contingent debt. It's a little bit different from public debt. Contingent debt in the sense of promises to pensioners. It's not a fixed amount of money, and taxes are not fixed. It's kind of vague, and you expect maybe some small increases, but it's not as precise as a bond payment, which means it's hard to measure this contingent debt. And, of course, one solution is you gradually change the age at which you're eligible for a payment, and you raise taxes, et cetera. So it's an important point, but it's related to the national debt, but it's a slightly different.
Well, as I was moderating, I saw a tweet flash past my screen saying the solution, conclusion of this participant after listening to these guests for a long time today, expanding on the history of defaults, is in Europe we'll just print and hope for the best. And so I think that's something that our next panel after the coffee break will be able to comment on the merits of doing that. And thank you very much for your attention today.
Thank you very much.
And thank you for interesting discussion indeed. We will resume 15 past 11 sharp. Please come back from the coffee break, which will be at the opposite side of the hall. Thank you.